Okay, now welcome to lecture two, Attribution. Today we will be talking about attribution, which is topic three in the Hock and Vaughan book. As you easily notice, I skipped chapter two, which is social cognition and social thinking. There will be also no specific questions about social thinking and social cognitions as far as chapter two is concerned in the final exam. I've just made this decision to focus on some topics in social psychology and leave out some others because we don't have time for everything. I focus on the things that I find most important, most interesting, or topics on which I have done research myself. And attribution is one of the things that I think everyone should know, because these basic attribution processes do help us to understand our everyday lives a little bit better. But let's first talk about the multiple choice questions from last week. I do not know how many of you participated. I was in Moscow until yesterday, and every slide that I will be showing you now has been prepared by Felix Schopmann until yesterday, and I haven't seen them before. So I don't know how many participated, but what I've seen by screening the slides is that most of you got the answers right, but for some answers, or for some questions, there's at least a little bit insecurity or uncertainty involved. So the first question from last week, or that I presented you in the online assessment, is: the use of the scientific method in social psychology implies that either A, researchers blind themselves to intuitive approaches, or research predictions are derived from theory, or C, qualitative methods are rigorously avoided and downgraded, or an experiment is conducted in a laboratory setting. How many of you think answer D is correct? Only very few think answer D is correct. And answer D is incorrect, because the scientific method does not only imply conducting experiment in a laboratory. Social psychologists often do experiments in laboratories, but we can also do research by natural field experiments outside of the academic environment. We do sometimes research using archival data. Sometimes we do correlational research by observing or surveying people. This is all scientific method, but it does not necessarily mean it has to be done in a laboratory setting. Qualitative methods are rigorously avoided and downgraded. How many think this is true? No one, and this is correct. Although I must say that many of my colleagues may be highly skeptical of qualitative methods. So typically I would think that in our department, qualitative methods are not very often used. So it's not a very common, very typical method that we psychologists use in our research. But sometimes we do use this, and sometimes it's interesting, and it's definitely a scientific method if you rigorously do qualitative research. I've done qualitative research, for example, in the area of mergers and acquisitions. And sometimes you can only do a qualitative study when you have limited access to participants. For example, once we did a study on 16 top executives of a big firm that merged with a different firm. And we only could do interviews with these top executives. And the best method you can do when you have only small sample sizes is sometimes qualitative, in-depth structured interviews that you afterwards analyze carefully. And the most important thing for qualitative and for quantitative research is answer number B, that the research predictions are derived from theory. This would be the correct answer here for this question, and 84% of those who participated in the online assignment got it right. So most of you found that research predictions are derived from theory would be the correct answer, and this is true. As I said, I don't know how many people participated. I don't know whether this is based on 100 or 200 or just 20 people who participated in the online assessment. But I would strongly encourage you to do this and to help us determining before the lectures on which questions or in which areas you might have the most questions, or on which my lectures and my slides have been probably a little bit unclear. Okay. The next question was, Karl Popper defined a scientific hypothesis as one that can either A, be disproved but not proved, B, neither proved nor disproved, proved but not disproved, or never be stated confidently. I can make this relatively short. 72% have submitted the correct answer to the online assessment system. Once I asked my daughter, when she was like 4 years old, 3.5 or 4 years old, and I asked her, do you think that I can state that every swan is white if I would observe 1,000 white swans? And my daughter said, no, Papa, you can't. Because you never know whether there would be one black swan round the corner that you haven't seen yet. And this is exactly what Karl Popper said. We can disprove theories from finding disconfirmatory evidence, but we cannot prove a theory from finding as much confidence or as much evidence as we like. So a theory can easily be disproved, and then remember the scheme that I showed you last week. If we conduct an experiment from deriving from hypotheses that are derived from the theory, and if our experiment or our study delivers data that supports our theory, then our confidence in the theory increases, but we cannot state that our theory has been proven, because the next experiment will or might unravel something different. But from finding contradictory evidence, our theory can be either disproved, or at least we need to think anew and maybe think to how to modify the theory. Okay? And Karl Popper's famous example is the white swan. At a broad level, research in social psychology can be said to use two types of methods: quantitative and statistical, discursive and narrative, correlational and multivariate, experimental and non-experimental. Who thinks answer B is correct, discursive and narrative? No one. Discursive and narrative research is a little bit what we also could call qualitative research. But it's just two ways of saying the same thing. Discursive and narrative research is identical. It's only different researchers who prefer different terms. Who thinks answer A is correct, quantitative and statistical? No one. Okay. Quantitative and statistical, of course, we do quantitative research a lot by gaining data. Statistical is probably a different word of saying this, or you can say you can do a quantitative study and then you use statistics to analyze whether your effect is strong or moderate or weak, significant or not. But it's a similar thing. It's not two types of methods. Correlational and multivariate. Who thinks this is correct? One, two, three, four. A few. So often we do correlational research. Yes, when I hand out a survey to you and analyze the relationship between self-esteem and performance and something like this, then I do correlational research. And when I have more than one dependent variable, then I use multivariate analyses to see whether I have significant effects or which predictors are the most strong ones. But again, it's very similar thing. It's not two completely different types of method. The correct answer is experimental and non-experimental. As I've said, as an answer to question one, psychologists often do experimental research, but they also often do non-experimental research. And what differentiates experimental from non-experimental research is that there's an independent variable, and that this independent variable is A, held constant, B, out of control, C, the same for all participants, or D, manipulated. Almost everyone got this one right, manipulated. Remember the slides that I showed you at the end of last week's session? You would want to test the theory that aggression can be learned from observing violent content in television and films, and then you conduct an experiment and you derive the hypothesis that when you show one group of children aggressive content, then this group of children will also behave more aggressively in a later on measurement. And when you randomly assign the children to one of the two conditions and you show violent content to one group and nonviolent content to the other group, then this is the independent variable that is manipulated by you as researchers. Okay? Any questions to this question? Because there were at least a few who were not completely sure which was the right answer. But I think this is the core of psychology, the core of social psychology. You have to understand the elements of experimental research. And I think most of you have been through the Experimentalpraktikum last semester, so most of you have heard these terms quite a few times before, but I do admit that sometimes they can be a little bit confusing: independent variable, control variable, dependent variable, random assignment, etc., etc. The important elements in an experiment are that you have an independent variable that you could manipulate, and you have a dependent variable that you measure. And when you manipulate the independent variable after randomly assigning participants to one of your factors or one of your treatment factors, then any changes in the dependent variable can only be due to changes in the independent variable, your manipulation, particularly when you do a laboratory experiment in which you try to keep all other factors either constant, like room temperature, time of the day, day of the week, etc., or you control for them, like age of participants, etc. Okay? But you can control for many variables also in field research, both experimental and non-experimental. You can, in survey research, typically you gather demographic information and you want to know whether it does make a difference, whether people are younger or older, have work experience or not, have children to care for or not. These are all variables that you can control but not manipulate. And either you held them constant or you measure them and use statistics to control for them, such as covariate analysis. Okay? Any questions to this online assignment assessment, to the four questions we just discussed? So I would like to start with this every week now. So hopefully as many of you as possible participate in the online assignment so that we really know that this 10% would reflect 10% of the people here in the lecture hall. And if it's more than 10%, if it's 20 or 30 or 40%, then I think those 30 or 40% should come forward and raise their doubts or tell us why they have thought that a different answer alternative was correct, because then I can rehearse some things or we can discuss about them. Okay? Okay, then we had three online forums, and one problem was that in the online forum only those people could see what the others have written who themselves contributed to it. It may be a nice way of making people contribute, but that was not what we intended. What we have changed it now, and from now on the forums, the discussion forums, should be available to everyone who is enrolled in this course and looks at the forums. We got a few discussion statements on all three questions, and I only very briefly want to talk about this one. So the topic was, discuss the trade-off between unethical research that yields large amount of information and ethically appropriate research that may yield much less information. How far is it acceptable to push our ethical boundaries, and who should say how far we go? I don't know how many of you thought about this, how many participated. There were only a few answers, I think 5 or 6 answers to this question. Some of them were very interesting. Here are 2 examples. I think one should always consider the importance of the subject of research in comparison to the extent ethical criteria might be harmed. That's certainly true. Another student or another participant was more critical. I think that any information obtained by unethical research methods cannot become a good benefit of knowledge, because you always have to consider the circumstances under which information was gained. And if you think of really, really terrible research done by the Nazis in the concentration camps, and I think one of the students in the discussion forum referred to that, this cannot be good research, and we should not use them when people were forced to participate in studies in research that was doing harm to them. They were never debriefed, etc., etc. We know all these cruel things that happened. This cannot be good research. It can also not be good research when pharmaceutical companies paid the former GDR officials to run experiments with patients without their knowledge, without their consent, without people knowing that the medicament, that the drugs they were prescribing had any dangerous side effects, etc. This cannot be good research. But of course there's a trade-off, and the first ones, the question we also ask is, who should say how far we go? And what we typically do is, most of our research is low-level research in terms of ethical problems. When we do survey research, it's pretty obvious what we are doing. We rarely deceive people and tell them lies about what it is about. When we do lab experimental studies, it's sometimes necessary to deceive people and to tell them that we are doing research on slightly different things, or that we are interested in things that we are actually not interested in, to put them on the false trail. But the important thing is that we have to balance the amount of deception to the knowledge we hope that we gain, and we have to debrief participants afterwards. And if more than deception is involved, if any imagined or implied damage to other people, for example, is involved, then we have an institutional review board or an ethics committee in our institute, and we have to submit applications there if we really think our research might be on the ethical boundaries and we would like to get an expert opinion. And we have this ethics committee led by Tilman Habermas and Sabine Windmann, and they have formulated criteria, and they have a little review system. So when you submit an application and you say, I would like to do this and that research, then they give you an answer and say, it's okay. And they use the American Psychological Association's ethical guidelines or principles as a rule. Or they say, nah, the way you thought your experiment should go is not perfectly in line with these guidelines or principles, and please consider to modify your application and to debrief your participants more completely, or ask them for informed consent before you run your study, etc., etc. So we need to do all we can to avoid harm with our participants. Yes, please.
Psychology, that if I think about ethical psychology and all there are a lot of experiments of private, where they explore that kind of brain.
Yeah.
So for me, it's an asymptote. And it's not.
Yeah. Yeah, I think this is in. The question was animal experiments, experiments with animals. Are they unethical in principle? Because, of course, we don't ask the animals for consent, or we destroy the animals by the sheer setup of our experiments because it involves brain surgery and thus damage, and typically the animals are also killed after the experiments. I think for those types of experiments, other ethical standards probably apply that are not defined by us psychologists, not by the American Psychological Association, because these ethical principles are applicable to human research or research with humans. I also know that there are guidelines, there are principles, and these colleagues also have to go through research boards. Particularly also you need more, typically more money than the experiments that I do in my laboratory. So typically the funding agencies like the German Science Foundation have their own principles that also need to be complied. And I think it's different standards that we might discuss here or might not. I would not say all research on animals by principle is unethical, but I do see that there are some people who are of this opinion and that constantly try to argue and constantly try to at least modify the principles that at the least damage is done to the animals that is possible by selecting the setup of the experiment, by selecting the sheer number of participants, number of subjects that are used, etc. But I do agree that this is an ambivalent topic, and you can have various views on it. Okay, there was one other question that I found interesting because this seemed to have sparked some interesting discussions. The question was, what do you think is the main reason for the US government shutdown? And there was an interesting debate between two gentlemen, and one of them was apparently also a US-American citizen. And I found his answer very interesting. He said the American system does have almost by nature and not intended by the original constitution, only two parties. And when you only have two parties, you have to have the opposite standpoint, because otherwise you would be too easily unrecognizable. I find this very interesting. I mean, we are used in Germany to have at least three, or over the last 30 years, four, now up to five or six parties who are in the Bundestag. In the Landesparlament, we have even more parties. So the boundaries between these parties are become a little bit blurred. If you only had SPD and CDU, then obviously for every topic they have to have a very common ground within their party that's exactly the opposite of what the other party says. Otherwise, you have a problem. And one thing that this gentleman also referred to was the founders of the American Constitution never had in mind that politicians become elected members of the House of Representatives or in the Senate for a lifetime, that you will be professional politicians that do the job for 30 years or so, because that makes you also dependable on becoming re-elected. And this makes you dependable on having a name fighting the other party most fiercely. The original founders of the American Constitution probably had in mind that farmers and business people or doctors or teachers were elected for one or two terms in office and then they would return back to their farms, etc. I think it's not only a problem of America, I think it's also a problem of almost all democracies that people become politicians out of normal jobs sometimes. I think at the moment in the Bundestag, the job that is most frequent is the job of teachers. But most of them will probably never return to their teaching profession. And once you become dependent on the income that you generate, you also are dependent on a number of constraints, and you have to show off to the public whether your opinion is true or that your opinion is true, and therefore making compromises with the other parties is even more difficult than it was intended to be. And this is probably even emphasized or accentuated in a system where you only have two parties. I found this discussion interesting. I didn't think about this. Another thing that was mentioned was maybe the government shutdown and many other wrong decisions or difficult things in politics has to do with social loafing. I thought about this a little bit, and I think maybe there's a kernel of truth or something where I could relate these problems to the phenomenon on social loafing. We will discuss about social loafing in more detail in 3 or 4 weeks. Social loafing is that you exert a little bit less effort when you are a member of a group compared to when you are alone. And of course, as a politician and a member of a large party, you may always say, okay, there are 150 others who can read the law in detail, and then I will go with the majority and I probably don't do any wrong. Although each and every politician, and particularly members of parliaments and of governments, in principle, should be very well informed about every law and everything they vote for in the Bundestag and other parliaments. Okay? So I found this very interesting. I hope that there's more participation in the future when we have when we do overcome the technical problems that we had. And every week I will talk a little bit about this. And if you have a very different opinion, or if I see that there's controversial debate in the forum, then I would certainly also mention it here. Okay. Now I would like to talk about attribution. Attribution is, in general, how people make causal attributions for their own and others' behavior. The emphasis today will be on some theories of attribution, but we also talk about biases in the attribution process, and we talk about group and societal influences on our attribution. More specifically, we'll talk about basic attribution processes and some theories by Fritz Heider, Jones and Davis, or Kelly, a little bit about Schachter's adaptation to emotions and Weiner's attributional theory related to performance. And as I said, we will talk about biases a little bit as well. Although nonverbal behavior may be relatively easy to decode, you observe someone hitting another person. It's nonverbal behavior, and it may be relatively easy to decode. There is still often, or most of the times, substantial ambiguity about why people act the way they do. So I see someone beating another person, and I can easily see what's happening, but I don't know why this person acts the way he does. And attribution theory is a description of the way in which people explain the causes of their own and others' behavior. Okay? And Fritz Heider is considered the father of attribution theory in 1958. He published the first attempt to structure or systematize attributions. He believed that people are like amateur scientists or naive psychologists, and that they would try to understand other people's behavior by piecing together information until they arrive at a reasonable cause. Okay? So long as you arrive at a reasonable cause why this other person may have behaved the way he or she does, you try to gather information and put the information you get together. And it seems almost impossible to describe something without looking for such causal relationships, and also without using causal language. Typically, when we observe a correlation in a survey study or in a field study, typically we find it very difficult to describe that two factors, for example, self-esteem and performance, or personality variables and job satisfaction, are not only related, but that there is a causal variable that affects the other variable. We find this very difficult. And we even find this very difficult when we see meaningless objects. And I show you a little piece of the research that Haider himself has used. Just look at this. Okay, so what we see is triangles, rectangles, a circle being moved around by the one who makes this little film. What people typically observe when they see it is very different. This is only in German, but I will explain the gist in a moment.
Betrachtet die Krise beziehungsweise Entstehung einer Beziehung. Eine kurze Verlaufsschilderung. Der symbolisch betrachtet die Krise bzw. Entstehung einer Beziehung. Eine kurze Verlaufsschilderung. Ein großes Dreieck im folgenden Ehemann genannt, wartet in dem Rechteck auf Haus, auf seine Frau, den Kreis. Nach einigen Sekunden geht der Ehemann hinaus, sieht seine Frau mit einem anderen Mann, nämlich dem kleinen Dreieck, dahergekommen und macht ihr kurz Vorwürfe, warum sie denn noch nicht zu Hause sei und auf ihn warten würde.
So, probably you had very similar impressions when you used it. Probably you thought about something completely different. Maybe we can watch the little movie again and maybe you can see whether the attribution that this student made, that there's a husband who's waiting for his wife, that he sees his wife with another man, and that in the end he becomes angry and destroys the house. Maybe you can agree to this student, maybe you have a different story to tell. The point is that we find it almost impossible to attribute meaning to a meaningless collection of items that behave the way they do. And we also find it almost impossible not to use causal language. The cause and the error. What caused the husband to become angry and destroy the house? The behavior of his wife who runs away with another man. Okay? So Fritz Haider observed this and he came up with a very simple dichotomy. He proposed that people look for stable and enduring properties of the world around us. That is what we are doing when we attribute things. So attribution, or the process of attribution, does not mean anything other than we look for stable and enduring properties in the world around us. And humans seem to have this need, this inherent drive to do this, to reduce uncertainty, to reduce insecurity, to increase predictability of the world around us. We try to discover personality traits and enduring abilities in people or stable properties of the situation. And Haider proposed a simple dichotomy for people's explanations. Either internal attributions, when the behavior was due to personality traits and enduring abilities in the person that we observe, or external attributions when it was due to properties of situations. Very simple. Johnson Davis, some 10 years later, in their theory of correspondent inference, claimed that we seek to make inferences between what we observe and the underlying characteristic of the person. So Jones and Davis were interested in the internal part of Heider's equation. When do people make internal attributions and make this correspondence from observing behavior of a person to this person's underlying characteristics? And of course, we can use information from the social context to see if we can make such a correspondent inference. And these are the principles Jones and Davis determined in their theory or defined in their theory. We tend to make correspondent inferences more quickly, more easily, or more strongly when, for example, the behavior is not socially desirable. When you go out of the lecture theater and you see someone picking up stuff that a different person has lost or has dropped, then you would not necessarily make the attribution that this person is very altruistic, because it's socially desirable. Yes, we do help other people in little things. When you drop something, you would expect the people that stand around you to help you picking up your things again. But if we would observe someone pushing down the stairs, we would make this correspondent inference much more quickly, and we would assume that this is an aggressive person, a rude person, etc. When a behavior is freely chosen, when you would observe someone pushing someone else down the stairs, who him or herself had been pushed by the person behind him because there was a little chaotic situation, then you would not make the correspondent inference that this is an aggressive person. But when you see that this behavior was freely chosen, then you would more easily make this correspondent inference. Also, when the behavior is not part of a social role, when you observe a firefighting, rescuing someone from a burning building, you would not think that this is naturally a heroic behavior, because you know this is what firefighters are supposed to do. And it might still be good, and it might still be risky, and it might still be very helpful to the person being rescued, but you would not make this correspondent inference so easily. We do make correspondent inference much more quickly when the behavior has a direct impact on us. When someone is hitting us, we make a much more fast and simple inference about the other person's behavior than when this person is hitting someone else. And finally, this non-common effect thing. For example, when you have completed your bachelor program and you talk to other people who apply for master programs at good universities, and someone can apply for or has applied for two master programs, and both are at equally reputable, good universities, both would offer clinical psychology, but you know that the other person is choosing the program that requires additional weeks of internship or practice, then you might infer that additional training is relevant to that person. You cannot make inferences from the common effects of both behavior alternatives. So if this person would go to one of the other universities that both are reputable, don't tell you anything. Only the thing that distinguishes the two alternatives gives you additional information that helps you making this inference, what type of person the other one might be. Okay? So again, these are the five factors determined by Jones and Davis that make us drawing this correspondent inference a little bit faster, more quickly, etc. And these two theories, Haider and then Jones and Davis, were the very important for the work of Kelly. And Kelly in 1967 devised two attribution models. I only will briefly talk about the covariation model. The covariation model is applicable when you have multiple observations. Kelly also made some suggestions for what happens when you only have one observation. You cannot observe people behaving in accidents time after time after time. So you have to make a fast attribution about why did this accident happen. And Kelly suggested to use a configuration model. So you analyze the configuration of the situation in a one-off observation situation. For example, you observe an accident on the street and you see that the driver who gets out of the car is above 80 years old, gray hair or a head, and then you would immediately attribute the cause of the accident to this driver's age. Or you would see that there's leaves or sand on the street, and then you would make an external attribution and say this was probably caused by the situation because the road was slippery. But you only have this one observation, and quickly we make inferences here as well. We are in a slightly better position when we have multiple observations, and here Kelly used the metaphor of the ANOVA model, the analysis of covariation, which effects covaries with certain attributes of the situation and people involved over time. And we use consensus, distinctiveness, and consistency information to make our attribution. This means consensus information is the information regarding how other people besides the actor treat the target. When other people treat the target the same way as the actor, then consensus is very high. Everyone would treat the target the same way, and we cannot infer from the behavior necessarily that it is in the actor. Distinctive information is information about how the actor treats other people besides the target, and consistency information is about how the actor treats the target across time and maybe different situations. We are most likely to make an internal attribution when consensus and distinctiveness are low, but consistency is high, and we are most likely to make an external attribution when consensus, distinctiveness, and consistency are all high. So, if consistency is low, if we see that the actor behaves politely to the target in one situation and very impolite in the next situation and then polite again, etc., we cannot infer anything. And Haider called this phenomena discounting, so we have to search for a different cause. When we have a clear pattern of high consistency and both high distinctiveness and consensus, then we would make an external attribution. So typically we would attribute to the target. When we have high consistency, but both low distinctiveness and consensus, then we would make an internal attribution. And here's a classic example. So you see a boss is shouting at one of his employees, Hannah. People make an internal attribution, something about the boss, the actor. And they see something in him or her. So the boss may be a rude person, maybe an aggressive, choleric type of person. When there's low consensus, only the boss shouts at Hannah and not the others as well. When there's low distinctiveness, the boss shouts at other persons as well and not only at Hannah. And when there's high consistency, the boss yells at Hannah every time he sees her. We would make a rather external attribution. We think it's something about Hannah. She might be a not very conscientious employee. When we see high consensus, the other employees yell at Hannah too. When there's high distinctiveness, the boss doesn't yell at other employees, but only at Hannah. And again, when there's high consistency, so the boss is yelling at Hannah every time. People think there's something peculiar about the situation. It's neither the boss nor Hannah when there's low consistency. So whether there's low or high consensus and distinctiveness doesn't matter so much. We need consistency, according to Kelly, to take the other two factors into account and make an external or internal attribution. When there's no consistency, then probably we use elements of the other model, the configuration model, and we analyze this specific situation and we look at the customers that Hannah has served that day or whatever. Okay? These are the three most important attribution theories. Heider, very simple, we are all naive psychologists, we try to find the reasons behind people's behavior. It's almost impossible not to do that, and we use strong causal language when we describe other people behaving or when we describe events without having actual knowledge of causality involved. And he simply distinguished between internal and external attribution, but didn't tell us a lot about where we would get there. Jones and Davis focused on internal attribution and told us about the factors that make it more likely that we use or make this correspondent inference. And Kelly, so to speak, completed the picture by also giving us more information or an idea about when people would make external attributions and would look for causes of our behavior in the other person or in the environment. Okay? That's attribution theories in a nutshell. We will see one more theory in a moment. But first, let's talk about Stanley Schachter. Stanley Schachter extended attributional theory to emotions. And he suggested that emotions would have two very different components. On the one hand, there is the state of physiological arousal. And on the other hand, we need our cognitions to label the arousal and determine which emotion we experience. This is not state-of-the-art knowledge. We do know that people experience different types of arousal that are immediately related to different states of emotions. So neuroscience in the last 30 years has made considerable progress, and it seems that we have different types of physiological reactions to different arousals without having the need to cognitively attribute what this arousal is about and what we might feel. But this is not to say that Schachter's research is wrong, and this is also not to say that we sometimes also experience this rather unspecific arousal and that we do sometimes, or maybe even often, have our cognitions playing a large role in determining whether the same arousal is a positive or a negative emotion. What did Schachter do to prove his ideas, to prove the theory? Together with Singer, they devised an experiment where participants were given an injection, and the injection was always an epinephrine, which is a type of adrenaline that makes people aroused, or a placebo. And then they were either correctly informed, not informed, or misinformed. So the correctly informed participants were told, we give you an injection and it does make you a little aroused. The non-informed people weren't told anything, and the misinformed people were told, this is an injection and it does not do anything to you, it does not make you aroused. Participants then waited in a room with a confederate who either behaved euphorically or angrily. So the confederate of the experimenter in the euphoric condition made paper planes and threw them through the room and told little jokes and made funny faces. In the angry condition, the participants were hitting on the desk and shouting at the waiting time was too long and he was angry about the experiment, etc. Now, put yourself in the shoes of the participant. You've just given an injection, and either you've been told that this makes you aroused, or this does not make you aroused, or you were not informed, or you were given an injection and told that you were aroused or not aroused, but in fact it was a placebo and you weren't aroused at all due to the injection. Now, what would you think about your own emotion that you were probably feeling? Schachter and Singer said, you would determine the emotion attached to your physiological arousal due to the behavior of the participant, of the confederate. And the results confirmed the prediction. The drug misinformed participants experienced unexpected arousal, and they searched for a cause in the environment. They didn't have to make an internal attribution, or they couldn't make an internal attribution. The behavior of the participants served as a cue or salient cue which encouraged the participants in the euphoric condition to label the arousal they were feeling as euphoric and in the other condition as anger. Participants in the no drug conditions, in the placebo conditions, experienced no arousal and therefore they correctly informed participants already. Sorry, not therefore. And the correctly informed participants already had an explanation for the arousal. So they knew it was the drug, and therefore they were not affected by the confederate. So it's one and the same thing of arousal in the misinformed and informed condition. But in the informed condition, participants could make an internal attribution. They could make some sort of external attribution. They knew it was the drug, but they knew how they were feeling. They could label their arousal because they knew what the drug was about, where the other participants were behaving very differently and were describing their arousal as either euphoric or anger, depending on the confederate's behavior. Sis? Yeah, please. You mean your teacher thought that it was weird to read the experiments, or the participants were feeling weird?
Yes.
Even in the informed condition?
Yes.
I don't know. Maybe there's some criticism on this as well. I know that, therefore I've said that this is not Schachter's original theory, that we always need cognitions to label the arousals that would be the same, no matter whether we experience anger or distress or sadness or happiness. This is not state of the art. So we know from neuroscience that there are very different specific arousals for these different emotions. But I still think that this experiment confirms that sometimes, at least, our cognitions do play a large role in determining what we actually feel. We will see when we talk about aggression, there's also this classic notion of unspecific residual arousal. So imagine you have to come here to university and you are a little bit late. So you have to rush from the train or from the bus. And when you get into the lecture theater, you are still physiologically aroused. Your blood pressure is a little bit higher than when you would be very calmly walking across campus to the lecture theater. But by the time you are up here, you don't remember this anymore because it's not salient anymore that you had to rush to catch the train or whatever. But there's still residual arousal. And when there's another person who cuts you short or who blocks your way, then you might be very angry because you attribute your anger to the other person because of this residual arousal that you cannot correctly classify anymore. It's different when you are in a gym and you are exercising, and right after you leave the room, someone is insulting you. Then you know that you should probably wait a few seconds and calm down because you are still aroused because of the exercises. So I do think that there is still something to it. I still think it's a clever experiment. It might be true that the participants were feeling a little bit awkward. I mean, how would you feel when you were waiting in a room for an experiment and then there's someone else who is making jokes and funny faces and throwing paper planes? I mean, that's what we social psychologists do. And sometimes the experiments are cleverly designed and the participants don't know what to expect, and they believe all the cover story, and they believe that the other person is for some reason or not a funny person and makes all these things. And sometimes we don't believe this. And you always have to remember, when I talk about studies from 1950s, 1960s, even early 1970s, it was not everyday people's knowledge what social psychologists do in their experiment. It was not even the case that every psychology student knew what a typical social psychological experiment would be looking like. The mainstream psychology of the 1950s and 60s was psychoanalysis. So people were getting into a laboratory, being measured, being deceived by the experimenter, etc., was very new to these people. And they didn't have heard about Milgram and Zimbardo and Schachter and Kelly and all these. So in a way, the people may feel a little bit awkward and they don't believe everything, but they probably also not clearly attribute to their feelings to the experimenter being very nasty. Yes, please.
Because it's correct informed, not informed, or misinformed. Not informed is strange.
This is strange indeed. Probably these were the people having received the placebo. Yeah.
But they don't know that they got a placebo, so you also have to tell them anything.
That's true. Maybe they were told it's just a vitamin, what we typically say. I don't know. Yeah, the placebo people. Maybe the misinformed and the placebo people were all told it's a vitamin. Okay. Final theory quickly is Weiner. And Weiner devised a theory, an attributional theory, mainly for achievement attributions. So you have an exam in front of you or behind you, and now how do you attribute success or failure? And Weiner defined three factors: locus, stability, and controllability. Locus is a question whether the performance caused by the actor or the situation, so internal or external, as in Heider's model. Stability, is the internal or external cause stable or unstable? Well, that's more or less consistency in Kelly's model. And controllability, to what extent is future task performance under the actor's control? These three factors, according to Weiner, are relevant and provide us with eight different combinations. So when we have a controllable situation that is stable, and I know success or failure are due to my own internal effort or not, typical effort is what we attribute. So when we pass the exam, when we get a good grade, then we say, okay, I've studied enough, I've revised hard, I'm knowledgeable about the subject, the topic, and typical effort is the attribution we make. If I fail the exam, I may still say, okay, I almost never study enough, I'm not so knowledgeable about it, it's still an internal cause that I could control if I would study more in the future. Luck would be very difficult. Luck is something external. I cannot control luck. I'm not in charge of luck. I cannot. It's uncontrollable, external, and by definition, it's unstable. Task difficulty is also something external. It's the examiner. Maybe he is having a good day or a bad day, and maybe he's making the task very difficult. It's about math, and I never know what it is. So stable, uncontrollable for me, and it's the examiner, it's the teacher who is setting the exam. Mood is unstable, internal, and also uncontrollable. Ability is uncontrollable, internal, but rather stable, and so on and so forth. So typically we make these types of attributions either when we expect failure or success, or when we have passed an exam or failed an exam in hindsight. These were the attribution theories in a nutshell. And now I'm talking about biases in attribution. These are very important because every theory more or less suggests that we are really, really rational when we make these attributions, when we try to find the cause behind the effects that we observe. When we make these correspondent inferences, it looks also technical when we go through the ANOVA model or Wiener's model, and it suggests that we are rational animals, but we are not. As we all know, we make errors, and there are biases, and there are a lot of biases in our attribution processes as well. So there are these biases that I would quickly like to talk you through: fundamental attribution error, actor-observer effect, self-serving biases, the false consensus effect, and the ultimate attribution error. Fundamental attribution error is a tendency to overestimate the extent to which a person's behavior is due to internal dispositional factors, and that we underestimate the role of the situation. And it's called fundamental because we all seem to have this tendency. We all seem to underestimate external and overestimate internal factors that contribute to whatever we observe people do. This was formulated by Jones, and Jones and Harris in 1967 conducted this little experiment to test their theory, to test their idea. They were given participants essays that were written by other, ostensibly other participants. And these essays were either pro Fidel Castro or contra Fidel Castro. This was a hot topic in 1967 in the United States. So probably people who would write essays in favor of Fidel Castro were considered left-wing and communist and very different from the US mainstream, etc. Whereas people writing an anti-Castro speech would just go with what the normal politicians or media or newspapers would tell them. And they were asked to read these essays and then to evaluate on a scale between 0 and 100 to what extent the person was actually in favor or not in favor of Fidel Castro. And the experimental the independent variable that was manipulated was choice or no choice. The real participants were told that the participants who had written the essay before did have free choice to write a pro or anti-Castro essay. In the other condition, in the no-choice condition, they were told, you will be given an essay, and please read it and evaluate the person's attitude, but this person didn't have a choice. We told them to write a pro-Castro essay, or an anti-Castro essay in the other condition. And what you see is, when the real participant thought it was a free choice of the other person, there's this large difference. So those people who read the pro-Castro speech and who assumed that the other participant had written the essay out of choice, were attributing a very pro-Castro attitude. Those people who read the anti-Castro essay and thought that the other person had written the anti-Castro essay out of free choice were attributing a much less positive attitude. So these people were thinking, no, this other person really is anti-Castro. Now, what's interesting, in the no-choice condition, you basically have the same effect, only a little bit attenuated. So there's less emphasis, or there's less of a difference, but you have the same effect. Those people who have read the pro-Castro speech were still thinking that the writer's attitude was far more pro-Castro, and they who have read the anti-Castro speech were thinking that the other person who has read the essay was far more anti-Castro, although they knew that they hadn't written the essay out of their choosing. They were made writing either a pro or an anti-Castro essay by the experimenter. And you do see that people take this into account, so the difference here from 50 to 25 is far lower than the difference between 65 and 20. But you also see, and this is a fundamental attribution error, that people underestimate the role of external factors, situational factors. In this case, the experimenter that told the other participants either to write a pro or anti-Castro essay. The fundamental attribution error does not say people ignore the situation. People never look at external factors. Fundamental attribution error says we typically overestimate the internal and underestimate the external factors, and this is what we do see. Yes, please.
But did they control, for example, the attitude of the participants before the experiment?
Of the real participant?
Yes, of these two groups.
I don't know whether they controlled for it. But I do know that they have made a random assignment. So it might be, it's very plausible that the real participant who read the essay had a variety of attitudes to Castro themselves. So some were more positive, others were probably more negative. The mainstream would be probably more on the negative side because of the general climate at that time. Today, psychology students in the US would typically be considered liberals, so typically if you would do the same experiment today, then I would expect most people to be rather a little bit pro-Castro than anti-Castro. I think at that time it was different. But there was a distribution, there was some variation of this attitude. But if you do a random assignment, and you make sure that exactly the same number of people with a very strong pro or anti-Castro are in both conditions, and this should not affect the results. Similar question, or?
Well, I was thinking, how did they control the quality of the writing?
Oh, they weren't. Of course, there was never a real participant. There were two essays that were identical. They were written by the experimenter. So there were two essays, one was pro, one was anti, and all the participants read the same essays written by the experimenter. And one was pro and the other was anti. Yes, please. Thank you. That's a very interesting question. And at the very last slide today, I will talk a little bit about this. I will present you one study that has differentiated between Indian and American samples, and we show that there are some differences. Yeah. Okay. Why do we do that? Why do we overestimate internal factors, underestimate external factors? One reason is that we as observers focus our attention on the actor. The actor is salient. It's a figure in front of a not salient ground. The situational causes of the actor are less salient and maybe even unknown. So actors typically know the situation. They know how they have responded in different situations before. They have access to more information according to Kelly's model, but also to Jones and Davis' model, for example. And this is called perceptual salience. All the information that is the focus of people's attention helps explain why the fundamental attribution error is prevalent. Perceptual salience. And you may remember when I've greeted you as first-year bachelor students, I said that here in Frankfurt, Kafka and Köhler and Wertheimer devised Gestalt theory. And this is one of the fundamental principles of the Gestalt theory, that we tend to see the figure in front of the ground. So when we see something that is sticking out, standing out, then we pay our attention toward this figure and we ignore, we don't perceive the not salient, non-salient ground behind it as much as we should or could. And this has to do, or this explains perceptual salience, which partly explains the fundamental attribution error. And Taylor and Fisk in 1975 did a small experiment. They had an actor A and an actor B, and they asked actor A and actor B to discuss a controversial topic. And you see that there's a number of observers. And this observer was asked to pay attention to actor A. This observer was asked to pay attention to actor B. These two observers were asked to pay equal attention to actor A and B. And you see that the seating arrangement also made observers A focus on actor A and vice versa for these two observers who focused on actor B. And after the discussion, people were asked to what extent the respective actor was having internal reasons to argue the way he or she acted, or external reasons. And here you see what happened. Those who faced actor B attributed the cause of the discussion or drew this correspondent inference between what they observed and an underlying personality characteristic of actor B much more to actor B than to actor A. It was a little less strong, but just in the opposite direction for the observers who faced actor A. They made a much stronger internal attribution to actor A as they made for actor B. And those observers who were seated in the middle and who paid attention to both actors A and B didn't make a lot of a difference and attributed almost the same amount of internal causes to both actors A and B. So perceptual salience is one reason why we make this fundamental attribution error. And this experiment has shown that this is plausible. Another attributional bias is the actor-observer effect. The difference between the actor and the observer is the tendency to see other people's behavior as dispositionally caused, but focusing more on the role of situational factors when explaining one's own behavior. Okay, so the fundamental attribution error is the underlying error we all make. When we see something happening, we overestimate internal factors in others, but also in our own behavior. And the actor-observer difference now says, yeah, but although this might be the basis, actors do this a little less than observers. Observers will much more attribute internally to the actor than the actor him or herself, because actors have more knowledge of the situation. Oh, I do that later. One reason for the actor-observer effect is, again, perceptual salience. Just as in the fundamental attribution error, actors notice the situations around them, they will know their behavior in the past, etc. observers notice the actors. And the actor-observer difference also occurs because actors have more information about themselves. So it's not only that the situation varies, and as an actor I have more information about the situation, I have more information about my feelings, my thoughts, my personality characteristics, my disposition in general. Okay? Up until 2006, we all thought that the actor-observer effect was true, and it's in almost every textbook, including the Hock and Vaughan textbook. And then a guy called Malle, we don't know, published very influential meta-analyses with hundreds of studies, and he actually showed that the actor-observer bias is actually not existent, or very small at best. So since this meta-analysis, we doubt that there is a thing as the actor-observer bias as such. There's still the fundamental attribution error. And there's one other thing. This meta-analysis did show that there's an asymmetry for negative events, but a reversed asymmetry for positive events. What do you think? In which direction does this asymmetry point? When do you think? Yes, please.
I think in general it's more important for humans to remember negative events, because negative events would, if gone really wrong, cause you to die, while positive events would only cause you to feel a little better.
Yes, that's true. But does not describe the actor-observer difference or asymmetry. But yes, it's true. Thanks. Yeah.
So it's supposed to be about the asymmetry of internal and external. Mm-hmm. So I think in the case of a negative event, you would rather try to explain that by external factors, like if you fail an exam, then you say, oh, it was very hard, and I did study that, but the question for me is something. And when it's a positive event, you rather say, well, I did it, I learned enough.
Thank you very much. This is exactly right. And we call this, even before the meta-analysis by Mahler, we call this self-serving biases. There's a number of self-serving biases that are explanations for one's successes, credit internal or dispositional factors, and explanations for one's failures, blame external or situational factors. So defensive attributions, for example, are explanations for behaviors or outcomes that avoid feelings of vulnerability and mortality. Unrealistic optimism is a form of defensive attribution when people think that good things are more likely to happen to them than to their peers and other people, and vice versa, that negative events are less likely to happen to them than to their peers or other people. One way we deal with tragic information about others is to make it seem it could never happen to us. When you hear a story about someone in your hometown having a terrible accident or being mugged or his car is broken, his house was broken in, whatever, we believe this cannot happen to us. And we call this a belief in a just world. This is a form of defensive attribution where people assume that bad things happen to bad people and that good things happen to good people. This is, it sounds funny, but there are a lot of cases when this has important implications even in our juridical system. Think about how we typically deal with stories of rape. When a woman gets raped, typically it's not only other men that say, yeah, but she dressed provocatively, or she was out on her own in an area of the city where she should probably not have gone to make an attribution that is part the victim's problem or part of the victim's situation. It's also sometimes other women that make this attribution to protect themselves from the negative events, to protect themselves from the feeling that it can happen to them as well. Yeah, she is a bad person, and I've heard stories about her behavior in the past. And this is, of course, very, very negative. It's critical. It's critical because it influences how the police, how lawyers, how neighbors, relatives, witnesses, etc., perceive the whole situation. So the belief in a just world can protect our self-esteem, our self-concept, but it obviously is a bias that needs to be corrected because we want people to talk about these things as objectively as possible when we are at court and analyzing the situation. When people anticipate failure, they sometimes intentionally and often publicly make external attributions even before the event. This has been called self-handicapping. So when you let everyone know when you walk into the classroom for the final exam, when you let everyone know that you were on a big party yesterday night and you drank far too much and you came home far too late and that because of other events in your private life you didn't have time to study enough anyway. So if you expect failure, then you engage in this self-handicapping behavior to be able to afterwards attribute the negative event not to your internal factors that Weiner, for example, would call stable and controllable ability. You would not have to say, yeah, I'm a dumb person, I just don't understand social psychology. You can say, oh, it was just because of the drinks the night before. I could do much better, of course. Yes, please. Yeah, so she said I gave a number of examples, and of course these examples differ in extremity or intensity, and I only use these examples to illustrate the situations. I do think that for each and every situation the amount of these biases are very different. So sometimes we really over-exaggerate, and sometimes we don't do that. So for example, when we talk about a rape victim, we would probably not make these attributions in public and freely talk about them and freely try to say that we think the victim is it's partly her fault that she got raped to execute exempt ourselves from being a victim in the next situation. So we would not normally do that, but it might still be in our mind. It might still be in the back of our mind, and lawyers or police people who have to deal with the victim might not be as objective in this situation because these biases do play a role, but maybe only a little bit. Here in self-handicapping, people do that a lot, and you observe people doing it all the time. Particularly male people who say, I've been out for a drink yesterday night. You do hear that quite frequently and publicly, and people do think that this is actually true. This is a little study by Bergler St. Jones, who have tried to find empirical evidence in the laboratory. They asked people to work on very difficult puzzles. Some of the puzzles were actually solvable, other puzzles were not solvable. But all participants, after working on the puzzles for a couple of minutes, were being given the feedback that they were doing really, really well. Then the participants knew that there was another set of puzzles to solve later on. But in between, they could choose between two drugs. And one drug, Actavil, would improve their performance. The other drug, pandocrine, would hinder their performance. Now, the people who had worked on the solvable problems and would be given positive feedback, you've done really, really well, they thought, okay, I'm able to solve these puzzles. So if I take Acthavir, even better, then I solve more puzzles, or I'm out of the laboratory more quickly, or whatever. So you'd see that almost 80% of people in this group choose the performance-improving drug, and only under 25% pandocrine. Now, for those people in the non-solvable puzzle condition, the picture is very different. You worked on a not-solvable puzzle for a couple of minutes, and you really couldn't bring the pieces together. Still, the experimenter tells you, you've done really well. Better than average, or I don't know what they were told. So you must feel, it was luck. It was something, I even didn't understand it, so the positive feedback was just sheer luck. Probably when the next puzzles I'm going to solve are as difficult as that one, I will not be lucky again, and I will fail. I will not be able to manage to put them together. So these participants had chosen pandocrine over Acthavir to a great extent because they assumed that they would fail in the second phase of the experiment and could then say, yeah, but it wasn't me, it was the drug. Okay? False consensus effect. When this effect is about seeing our own behavior as more typical than it really is. And students were asked on campus, would you willing to take a sandwich board, eat at Joe's and wear it for 30 minutes and walk around campus? Those who said, yes, I would do that, were also asked, how many of your peers, people here in this classroom, you think would do the same? And you see that 62% thought that others would do it as well. Those who refused estimated that 67% of the others would also refuse. They cannot be both right, obviously. So the false consensus effect is that we think our own behavior is typical, and if I do something this or that way, then most of the others probably do likewise. Why? Because we have a biased sample of similar others among our close friends, and these are the exemplars we typically think about when we are asked what do others or would others do. Our own opinions obviously are more salient to us. We fail to realize that our choices reflect what we and how we construe our environment, and we are motivated. And this is probably the most important cause. We are motivated to see ourselves as normal and good people. Okay, final slide, ultimate attribution error. Thomas Pettigrew called it the tendency to internally attribute bad outgroup and good in-group behavior and externally attribute good outgroup and bad in-group behavior. So when someone from our own group does something bad, we say it was externally caused, but when someone from the outgroup does something bad, we say, look, so are the people internally, and the opposite. And culture, and now back to your question, unfortunately we only have 5 minutes left. The fundamental attribution error, as we have said, is the inclination to conclude that people's behavior match their personalities, internal attribution. And although this is prevalent across cultures, so you find it in almost every culture, there are differences to the amount of how strongly we use the fundamental attribution error. And people from collectivist cultures are more likely than people from Western cultures to also notice the situation. And here's an experiment by Miller, who has asked North Americans and Indian Hindus about internal and external attribution. And what you can see is by the age of 8 or 11 years, there's not much of a difference. So there's no biological thing to the differences in how far the fundamental attribution error is used in various cultures. But from the age of 15 years onward, it goes apart, and adults are quite strongly differing, and North American make a far more internal dispositional attribution than Indian Hindus. I'm sorry to have exceeded the time a little bit. I would still ask you to participate in the online assignments and also to engage in the online discussion forums. We talk about how far is attributions damaging, can it cause disharmony, and again, what are different viewpoints of Europeans in the financial crisis. Thank you very much.